morning, everybody. Hey, it's good to, yeah, I am back. The Africa says hi. I can say that. Hey, this morning I have the privilege of introducing one of my friends. I've told you before that's the best part of this job is I get to invite some folks here that I think you need to hear from. Justin was here 2 years ago, and he just said, boy, there's a lot of people here. I said, 2 years ago, people were sitting on blue dots, like scattered around, and everyone else was in their dorms watching. But Justin Yim is our speaker this morning. Justin's a longtime friend. I hired him for his first job when he was a student at Gordon-Conwell. And Justin currently is working as ministry director with Christian Union on the campus of Harvard Law School. Justin is ministering to the Christian community and the Christian students and some of the most influential people of the future of law. So he has quite a congregation. Previous to his current work, he spent over two decades in the local church in New York State and in New Hampshire. He has served as lead pastor, executive pastor, youth pastor, worship pastor, and everything that falls in the middle. He now resides in Newburyport, Massachusetts with his lovely wife, Melissa, and their kids, Austin, Cooper, and Sawyer. Their oldest daughter, Sydney, is a sophomore at Purdue University on the women's volleyball team, which is rated number 5 in the nation in NCAA Group 1. So he is a Boilermaker, or has become a Boilermaker, or is at least is paying for a Boilermaker. But anyway, Justin Yim is a wonderful guy, great heart for Jesus, and let's welcome him here.
Good morning. Wow, you know, I could have just sat there and just listened to you all worship this morning and sing songs like that, and I would have been fine, and I'm sure you would have been fine with that as well. Hey, before I begin, can I just say a very short prayer? Would you just bow your heads with me? Father, oh, that we would hear your voice this morning and that we would soften our hearts. For your glory, and in your name do we pray. Amen. As in our short time together, I would love to just teach you maybe a couple things or share with you a couple things. And there's one thing, as I was thinking about when Bob told me that your theme this year was creating ripples, a legacy of faith, I thought to myself, wow, what a great theme. And boy, you can really go a lot of places with that. But this morning, I just wanted to actually perhaps share with you one bit of advice that has served me well, and hopefully it will serve you well. And as Bob has explained to you, I work on the campus of Harvard Law School, meeting with probably some of the most interesting people that I've ever met or ever will meet. And interestingly enough, I tend to share this piece of advice more than not lately. I tell them this. Are you ready for it? I'm going to drop a piece of wisdom on you. That you can only control what you can control, and you can't control that which you cannot control. Now, you may be thinking to yourself, duh. And you're probably looking over at Bob's like, Bob, you got this guy to come and share this morning? But I tell you that truth simply because, though it may sound like common sense, it is something that perhaps all of us, including myself, that we struggle with. Think about it. How many of you are in relationship? Just raise your hand real quick. How many are in relationships that you're willing to actually even, you know, admit that you're in a relationship? Okay. So, hey, listen, if the other person's watching, your hand better shoot up real quick. You know what I'm saying? So, in relationships, one of the common struggles with young people is like, how do I make them love me more? Right? How do I make them like me more? So much of our energies and resources trying to figure out, boy, I really like this person. What do I have to do to make them like me more, love me more? Can I tell you something? That is beyond your control. And yet, And yet, we try with everything that is within us. I will do what they want. I will do what they like and say what... That's beyond your control. You can only control what you can control. You cannot control what you cannot. Right? You cannot control. You know, it's kind of this New England, I would say Bill Belichickian kind of advice, right? Do your job. Don't do anyone else's job. So in this topic of creating ripples and leaving a legacy of faith, I thought that was an appropriate piece of advice when it comes to faith matters. And I wanted to relate to you that perhaps that same sort of advice would be helpful in understanding the nature of leaving a legacy of faith. Number one, listen carefully. Do not measure your faith by a singular act or an event. Do not measure your faith by a singular act or an event. But rather, measure your faith by your commitment to continual, faithful obedience. Now, how do I know this? Well, if you, interestingly enough, we are studying Hebrews on the Harvard Law campus this year, right? That's why I was so excited. I'm like, oh, Hebrews, great. If you look earlier into Hebrews, chapter 3, the writer of Hebrews actually refers back to Psalm 97. It says, today, if you hear God's voice, do not harden your hearts. And then he hearkens back to Numbers 13 and 14 when he recalls the plight of the people of Israel in the wilderness as they stood on the precipice, as they stood on the borders of the promised land. And though they were delivered from slavery years before, they questioned God's ability to take them into the promised land. And as you read through, they were saying things like, you know, let's appoint different leaders and we'd like to go back to Egypt. And the judgment upon them was that they did not see the promised land. See, if the danger is that if we measure our faith by one singular act or one single event, the danger is that we do not see the importance of living our days in the context of continual, faithful obedience. Do not measure the quality or your faith or faithfulness in the lens of one singular act or an event. Number two, the second thing that I would love for you to learn today is your faith or faithfulness does not create ripples in and of itself. Your faith or faithfulness does not create ripples in and of itself, but rather, now listen carefully, but rather, it creates the condition by which and with which God can create massive ripples. It creates the fertile soil of God's miraculous work. It's this idea of conditional blessings. You know, one of the things that we talk about a lot, that I talk about a lot with our students at the campus, is that there is a difference between God's unconditional love in God's conditional blessings or God's conditional graces. And somehow, we have intermingled those two ideas, and we talk about this idea of unconditional grace. And you know what? I don't think that's actually biblical. Have you heard this before? There's nothing I can do that will please God, that will please God more or any less. I tell you that is not true. That is not true. Throughout the scriptures, we see all these conditional statements. 2 Chronicles 7:14 being one of the most penultimate conditional statements. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, right? Forgive them of their sins and then heal their land. Can you imagine if we thought everything that God has promised to do, he was just going to do without any requirements? Think about it. Even salvation, when you come to faith, is a condition. If you repent and believe, then you will be saved. There are requirements and there are expectations to our walk with Jesus Christ. There are conditions. See, here's the difference. The way I would explain it is this. If we think that there is some sort of heavenly ledger somewhere and that God is keeping tabs of all the faith acts that we have, that is more of a transaction more than a relationship. Now listen carefully. Many of us, and I struggle with this too, right? That somehow our understanding of the gospel, our understanding of our salvation is just a transaction. That if I say a prayer, at one moment in time, I've got my ticket to glory. Let me stick that in a safe place, and I will live my life any way which I please. That's right. Can I hear an amen? Amen. I tell you, that is transactional faith. It's not the gospel. But the gospel is more relational. And let me explain it to you this way. How good of a relationship would you have? How good of a marriage would you have if you only spent an hour a week with your spouse or your girlfriend or boyfriend? It probably wouldn't last very long. But praise be to God. God is so patient. But it does not change the fact that there are conditions. Now, here's the thing. If you measure your faith by the measure of continual faithful obedience, it creates the condition in which God can do miraculous work. It creates the condition in which God can take you in his mighty hands and as a living stone create a massive ripple upon the water of life. So number one, don't measure your faith by a singular act. Your faith and faithfulness does not create ripples in and of itself. And number three, here's the important part. Creating ripples is not about you. Right? It's not. It is about being the echo of the ultimate and superior ripple maker, the God of this universe in Christ Jesus. Now, how do we know this? Well, in Hebrews 1, funny fact, as the writer of Hebrews speaks of the superiority of Jesus Christ, he says, Jesus is the radiance of God's glory and the exact imprint of his nature. And we, if we want to be like Jesus, we are to bear God's very image. That we, our primary vocation in life is to be God-imaging humans. And if that's the case, our calling, any ripples that we desire to make, is not about us. It's ultimately about our Creator and our Lord Jesus Christ and the people that he wants to reach. Now, how do I know this? My father is North Korean. He's no longer alive. He was a resident of the Hermit Kingdom back in the early part of the 20th century. And there is no logical reason that I should be standing here before you today. No logical reason. Both his parents died when he was very young, and his only surviving brother died when he was a teenager. Now the question is, how in the world did the gospel of Jesus Christ reach this orphan child in North Korea? Well, the answer to that question is perhaps, what does a life that understands that a continual faithful obedience is what defines faith? What defines a life that looks like that they understand that their faithfulness does not create ripples in and of itself? And that someone that understands that creating ripples is not about them, this is what it looks like. There's a picture I would love for you to see. It's the student volunteer movement. I think there's, did you all get the media? No, they did not get the media. All right. In 1886, there was a student conference in Northfield, Massachusetts, held by D.L. Moody. In July of 1886, a month-long conference. And they invited about 250 Christian student leaders from around 89 universities. And at that conference, a pastor by the name of William Ashmore, who was an American Baptist missionary to China, spoke of his passion for missions and the importance of missions. And by the end of that conference, over 100 of those students signed up to say, I desire to serve God overseas, spreading the gospel. And I believe with all that's within me, there's some historians that may disagree, that it is from that ripple that the gospel reached the Korean Peninsula in 1886 and following. Because for the next 60 years, the student volunteer movement mobilized over 20,000 students into the mission field. Talk about a ripple. What does a ripple look like when God creates the ripple with faithful, faithful Christ followers? Let me tell you about a revival called the Businessman's Revival in 1857, where a brand new pastor in downtown Manhattan named Jeremiah Lamphere felt like God was calling him to start a Wednesday night prayer meeting. He plastered posters all around the city saying, join us for a prayer meeting from 12 to 1 p.m., knowing that people could take their lunch breaks and come to a prayer meeting. The first week, 12 o'clock came, no one was there. 12:30 came, no one was there. And ultimately, only 6 people showed up. And instead of feeling defeated, he continued and intentionally decided to practice faithful obedience to what he felt like God called him to do. So he met again. Now, in this time, within the few years that he was doing this, the Great Depression hit. The stock market crashed. Well, wouldn't you know it, the next week, 25 people showed up. And the next week, 300 people showed up. And a few weeks into what they would now call the Businessman's Revival, he had to set up a tent because over 150,000 people showed up for prayer. And we now know that the revival that happened at the Businessman's Revival in the early part of the 20th century reached over 1 million people coming to know Christ And it spread all around the world. Now that is a ripple. Well, what would creating a ripple or being part of allowing God to use you, what would that look like in your life? What would that look like in your life? If our faithfulness is not defined by one singular act, but a life that's intentionally lived in faithful obedience. You know, this is something that's really passionate for us, for me, at the organization that I'm working for. And one of the things that I know that we've challenged our students and challenged our partners all around the country is to regularly devote themselves to fasting and prayer. And leaning into that, not just once, on a regular basis, so that we set the right conditions for God to do miraculous work. I challenge you this morning, if you can understand that your faithfulness is not defined by one singular event, but a series, an intentional decision, intentionality to live faithfully, it will mean that you will say no to a lot of decisions in your life that you know that will not please the Lord. It will mean that you will lean into things that, you know what? I'm not used to it, but I will read the Word of God every day. It may mean that you gather together, not alone, that you will gather together and say, you know, I want to make sure that I am in the right condition for God to cast me and my life to create a ripple that will last generations like He's done before. And gathering together to pray together and praying for revival. One of the things that happened out of the student volunteer movement was the other 150 that did not sign up to go into the missions. They came back to that 150 and said, would you now go back to your college campuses and share with your student body what you have seen God do here? And they did. And I believe there was massive revival on those campuses. Now I'll end with this. When I was attending Gordon Conwell, way back when, I remember coming to this campus when Prince Chapel was actually a thing. I remember coming to this campus, and I remember experiencing something like the student volunteer movement here among this student body. Students gathered on a Sunday night, worshiping God and seeking Him, drawing near to Him, considering Jesus, drawing near to Him, and pressing on, where they would confess their sins to one another. And I saw God do some amazing things. I saw God start to plant seeds of revival. If you could see that picture of the student volunteer movement of the 250 students, I would challenge you to see your face in that picture. If only you understood what it would take. If only you would offer yourself, if we would offer ourselves to be living stones and say, God, create a ripple that will last a generation. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this group of young people. We understand the vocation of our lives, that we are to bear your image in all things. Father, I pray that we would understand that faith is not just defined by one singular act or an event, but it is marked truly by a life of faithful and continual obedience to you. God, we welcome you into this place, and we know that it is your desire to make an impact on this world. For we know that it is not our responsibility to bring the world to Christ, but our responsibility to bring Christ to the world. I pray that you would impress upon each and every one of our hearts here this morning. Offer up ourselves, offer up yourself as living stones that God may do his miraculous work. In Jesus' name, amen.